Welcome to Connie Martinson Talks Books. Well, my guest Chris Krause has written a fascinating novel called Summer of Hate. It's published by the Semiotic Publishing version of MIT Publishing. Welcome, Chris.
Hi, Connie.
Thank you for giving me a book that left me thinking, and I think that's very unusual to come across a book that talks about a character named Kat who is running away from a man she has met on a sadomasochistic date place. Now, how does that start?
How does it start?
Yeah.
Well, I mean, the setup in the novel is you have her world and you have his world. Her world is kind of the quintessential urbane, sophisticated, kind of middle class, upper middle class, middle aged, kind of semi-life crisis. You know, she's established somewhat in her profession. It's begun to bore her. So in her spare time, she's cruising these kinky sex sites. And somehow, I mean, we never really know in the book whether the death threat is in her mind or if it's in reality. But she's driven into a kind of hysterical panic. Yeah. That, you know, this fear, this flight that drives her out of her normal routine, out of LA, and into Albuquerque, where she meets Paul. So if she weren't in this delirium, the story wouldn't take place, really.
And she goes to Albuquerque because she also is shrewd and sharp enough in real estate to know she can pick up buildings, rental, motels, very inexpensive, compared to what it would be someplace else.
And, exactly.
Yeah, and she won't use illegal help.
Yes, that's right. That's, well, I mean, that's part of the period aspect of the book. It's set in 2005, 2006, which is, we remember, that was the height of the Southern California real estate boom.
Yeah.
You know, that was when, you know, mortgage refis were being written on car hoods and, you know, prices were way out of control. So the character Kat Dunlop decides to kind of take advantage of that moment and sell some property that she owns, income property, and reinvest the money in a place that isn't so completely inflated and maxed out. And in the book, you know, the brokers are all saying, go to Phoenix, go to Las Vegas. Yeah. But, you know, she's an artist. She hates those places. She remembers that Albuquerque was kind of a funky college town. She knew some kids there who had a zine. So she goes to Albuquerque.
All right. Where did you learn so much about real estate? Because I'm reading it and I'm saying, oh, this must be what her real occupation is.
Well, all of my books are somewhat autobiographical. I don't really write about, I mean, the core of the experience in the book has to be one that I have lived through or closely observed. Otherwise, it wouldn't interest me to the degree that you spend, like, years working on it.
Uh-huh.
So I had experiences in my life that were similar to Kat Dunlop's. You know, coming here from New York, coming to LA from New York right after, you know, in the mid-90s, when certainly downtown LA and Echo Park were very depressed. And as somebody who'd lived in the East Village in New York, knowing that that new wave of gentrification was just inevitably going to sweep through downtown LA.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I think anybody who's been in the art world long enough, has lived in major cities, sees that happen over and over again.
Then there is the other side of the story, Paul. Paul has been in prison. He's part of that group of people who get caught up in the system and they have to keep paying for the rest of their lives unless they find someone like Kat. He's got a sister who's a doctor. And she says, okay, you can stay here for a while. And there's a man whom he had worked for, but the guy's a flake. I mean, he's saying, here's a car you can have, and then the next minute, I want it back.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. I mean, that's a really true and tragic situation, that it becomes harder and harder for people to rebuild their lives after they've gotten out of jail or prison. And so many people in the United States now are in jail and prison, and for really some of the most minor and petty crimes. But especially now that, like, employment screening has become more stringent.
Have you ever been arrested for a felony?
Exactly.
Yeah.
even a misdemeanor. And I mean, a felony can be, you know, not a terrible violent crime. A felony can be really, you know, like writing two bad checks.
Yeah.
You know, and once you have that record, it becomes impossible, almost impossible to attend school. Yeah. It becomes impossible to get certain kinds of jobs, really a lot of jobs. Yeah. And now that more and more of the jobs are sort of service industry chain corporate jobs, all of those jobs are people to, are, all those places are closed yeah. to people who have any criminal background.
Yeah. And that is Paul, who answers an ad in the newspaper, not on the web, in the paper. She has put a, I need a manager who's got X amount of credits. And he answers, she likes his voice on the phone, and he's hired.
Yes.
And that changes his life. But even changing it, he's still caught up with the past.
Right. Well, you know, his background is he's a recovering alcoholic. He's almost 40 years old, and he's been sort of drunk, sober, drunk, sober, drunk, sober all his life, as well as all of these punitive, you know, jail and yeah. prison experiences. So it's very hard for a person like that. You know, their brain becomes wired differently yeah. from a person who hasn't had those experiences.
Yeah. Then he's doing very well with her. She's a few years old and she's in her early 40s. And they discover they like each other a lot.
That's right.
Yeah. Again, if this is out of your background, have you known people who have been in jail who have this black cloud over their head?
Yes, I have known people like that.
Yeah.
Yes, I have. Philip Valdez, my current partner, has a background very similar to the character in the book. Mm-hmm. He now works with the homeless in downtown LA. He's become a psychologist, but he has that same background of, you know, he was homeless for a while. He was in and out of rehab. He was incarcerated for a while. Yeah. I mean, at a certain point, he just became sober finally for the last time yeah. and turned his life around. But it's very, very, very hard to do.
Yeah. Not only that, but way back is an accident that he had walked away from, and suddenly, because he's where they pick him up for either the light in the back of his car isn't working, the police look him up, and there it is. This was there a death, or was what had happened? He walked away from an accident, which is more than a felony.
That's right. Yeah, that is so right. And that became, you know, in the book, for Kat's character, and I think for the reader, that becomes really kind of morally queasy, sticky, ambiguous ground. You know, he hit this person, he drove off because he was drunk. He was, yeah. you know, would definitely have ended up in prison after the accident. And in all the years that he was in recovery, he avoided dealing with it. And one of the things I believe that people say in yeah. AA and NA is something about shutting the door on the past and not getting too yeah. mired in guilt and remorse.
Yeah.
So he and his sponsor had made this decision that they were just not going to adjust the facts of the accident. But then it comes up. In yeah. fact, a lot of people who are in recovery talk about how by the fourth or fifth year, that becomes like uniquely difficult because yeah. like that's when they've been living kind of normal lives, and all the residue of the past, yeah. the warrants, you know, the bad debts, the yeah. old people in the past, they all start to kind of flood in the door.
Why the title, Summer of Hate?
Well, because most of the action of the book takes place that summer. It was the summer of 2006. And I don't know if you remember that, but that was like the summer, that was the summer when Bush called in the National Guard, thousands and thousands of National Guard to help patrol the Arizona border. So there was this huge military presence at the border. It was also the summer of the heat storm. Do you remember that? I mean, everybody was like, you know, the big debate was like, is it a heat wave or is it a heat storm?
Yeah.
You know, because it didn't get cooler at night. It was just in the hundreds for days and days and days on end.
Yeah. I must say, I don't remember it, but I now, in reading the book, understand it.
Yes, maybe a little yeah. bit cooler out here in Santa yeah. Monica, but not much.
Okay. I tell you, Chris, it's beautifully written. There is also the part I didn't get too much into where, as he has become more upstanding and going to college, there's a woman he gets involved with, and how Kate will take care of that. Is she going to drop him? Is she going to help him? And she's no fool.
Right. Right.
And in the end, he's really knocking on her door again.
Right. Well, you know, yeah, that kind of thing at the end, it's like the last little bit of chaos, you know, that someone who's had a very kind of disrupted and disorderly life, you know, they kind of, you know, chaos is the comfort zone. So that kind of, you know, that romance at the end becomes like the last flirtation with a doomed life.
Yeah. Meanwhile, she has a marvelous life. She's in Chicago lecturing. She's in Australia. She is, and she has the buildings, except there's a guy named, who is a Tommy, who is absconding and embezzling her.
Right.
So as smart as she is, she's not as smart as she thinks.
Well, who is?
Chris, a pleasure. I will look forward to the next book. Will you autograph
my book?
Thank you
so much, Connie. It was so good to talk to you.
And we will be back with P. Moss and Vegas Knockout.